Very good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies today. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Our next item is the second of two evidence sessions on the committee's short inquiry into how effective the Scottish Child Payment is in reducing child poverty. Last week we heard from academics from York, Loughborough and Oxford Universities and the Institute of Fiscal Studies. And today we'll hear from a panel of stakeholders. I welcome Ruth Boyle, Policy and Campaigns Manager, Poverty Alliance, Jack Evans, Senior Policy Advisor from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, and Stephen Sinclair, Chair of the Poverty and Inequality Commission. Erica Young, Policy Advisor from Citizens Advice Scotland, also planned to be part of the panel, but as she is now unable to attend and sends her apologies. So thank you all for accepting our invitation. And just a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. If you just wait until I remember asking the question, say your name before speaking, and don't feel you have to answer every single question. And if you've got nothing new to add to what's been said by others, then that's okay as well. And can I just remind members and the panel if we can try and keep questions and answers as concise as possible. So without further ado, I will move on to the questions. And first person I'm going to bring in is Paul O'Kane. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I suppose we are particularly interested in this inquiry and understanding the effectiveness of the child payment in terms of the reduction of poverty. So I suppose the first broad question I'd be keen to get the panel's view on is, what do we know so far about the effectiveness of the child payment in terms of lifting children out of poverty? Start with Jack and go that way.
Okay, I think there's three really important parts to this. I think there's the first part is... Is that better? The first part is it's kind of globally recognised that cash transfers are a highly effective means of reducing and impacting income-related poverty. And the Scottish Child Payment, the way it's been designed and the level that it's at and the consistency which it's paid should indicate that this will be a very successful policy. You spent a while on the last session talking about the gaps in data limiting our ability to understand in real time what the impact has been. So that is a concerning gap in the data, and we can go into that a bit further if we want. But I think without the data, there's the third point is the evidence that we are gathering in qualitative ways shows a real impact that it's having. So in the JRF submission, we talked about the lived experience of people who've received it and how impactful that has been for their lives and for their families, impacting both their well-being and their financial security. We also conducted a kind of 4,000-person survey in the spring last year, which asked people about the impact of the Scottish Child Payment, and we found that 2 in 3 people were felt more financially secure once receiving the Scottish Child Payment. So what I would say in summation is, yes, it's been incredibly effective. We've seen that in the real lives of families, but just at the moment, we're not quite seeing that in the data, and I think that's more of a data issue than an effectiveness of the policy issue.
I just want to say thanks to the committee for inviting the Poverty Alliance to give evidence today. We're really pleased to be here. We know that people in Scotland believe in justice and compassion, and it's up to our political leaders to put those values into action. And we think that the Scottish Child Payment is a really good example of that happening in practice. It responds to a clear need, and it also responds to one of the structural causes of poverty, which is an inadequate income from social security. As Jack says, we've seen a demonstrably positive impact in terms of families' financial security. So when we look at the Scottish Government's interim evaluation of the policy, we see almost 8 in 10 parents saying that it's made a difference to their lives, and similar numbers saying that it's helped them to buy what they need. So we see that the Scottish Child Payment is having a clear impact on parents' ability to meet the essentials that their children require, but often in some examples, often going beyond those essentials and enabling them to have decency and dignity and strive for a life where they're able to thrive rather than just survive. In our Serving the Future research, we've seen parents describe it as a great thing, Save the Children. I've had parents telling them that it's amazing, it's enabled them to buy clothes and food. And also in the Child Poverty Action Group submission to this inquiry, we see the example of a parent who have said that the Scottish Child Payment has enabled them to spend time together, to do an activity like going to a play centre. And if I could just quote from that, they said, "Even if we don't have much money, I want them to be happy and have fun." And I think that's something we would strive for all of our children. So we definitely see a strong impact of the Scottish Child Payment in terms of parents' financial security. As Jack says, if we zoom out from that and think about it at a societal level, we don't quite have the data to make a definitive assessment of the impact of the Scottish Child Payment at that societal level yet. That is because, as Jack says, of time lag in the data, the undersampling of parents who are in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment, and also some uncertainty about that data, so how we can do year-on-year comparisons. But we're really clear that we do expect to see a very strong impact in terms of the number of children that are lifted out of poverty by that payment. So we think it's a really bold payment. It's a really bold policy perspective, and we think that it needs to be bolder still in terms of increasing in the longer term.
Stephen.
Thank you, Stephen Sinclair, Poverty and Inequality Commission. I'd echo the testimony and the evidence that you've already been given. It's unfortunate that the full impact of the Scottish Child Payment is not yet evident in the statistics. However, there are a couple of reasons for that have already been pointed out, and one that is additional is that the Scottish Child Payment is effectively mitigating the inadequacies of the UK benefit system. We have testimony going back many decades, and there was a House of Commons Select Committee report on the inadequacy of benefits which reported last year. In addition, although inflation is lower than it was during the extreme level of the cost of living crisis, inflation for essentials, fuel and food, is higher than the CPI or RPI calculation. And lower income households spend a greater proportion of their income on those essentials. So the impact is not entirely evident in the statistics, but it's very evident in testimony. The Poverty and Inequality Commission conducted a number of workshops. We've reported on it on our written submission. And the support and recognition and regard from recipients of the Scottish Child Payment is very evident. So we think it's an impactful policy, even though we can't point to its statistical impact yet in full. Hopefully, next year's statistics, which will show the benefit of the full rollout, that will be clearer.
Thank you very much. If I can perhaps just return to the point about data and about, because I think it was very helpful in terms of qualitative evidence, and we heard some of that last week as well. But I know that in evidence, Joseph Rowntree have said that, you know, we can't rush to definitive conclusions because of, the lack of data, despite the encouraging evidence which you've all just referenced. But I wonder if you might want to comment on what more data do we need, firstly. And secondly, obviously, the government model looks... Or we'll quote about 60,000 children being kept out of poverty, but I'm aware that that model obviously uses a range of factors in a kind of invented or imagined scenario, that if certain government policies didn't exist and the Scottish Child Payment was held against them. So I would be keen to get your view of that model and the accuracy of that. Jack, I don't know if you want to start.
So on that first part, on the data, the first question, so I think there's actually quite significantly worrying low quality of data. I think for an investment of around £400 million, which the Scottish Child Payment is, it's kind of unacceptable, the low levels of sampling that we see in FRS and HBAI data. So we'll be writing to the relative authorities about that to correct that as soon as possible, because we need to have those kind of metrics all kind of working. As much as the qualitative data is vital, we need to support that with the quantitative. On the modelling, I think we saw the committee's response, the panel's response last week to the modelling, and I think it highlighted that the modelling was done quite cautiously. It had a lot of health warnings on it about how seriously to take it. I think with all modelling, it's really important to understand that it kind of assumes the status quo. So modelling done a couple of years ago wouldn't have expected the 10% inflation rise. So I think that's to be taken into consideration with any modelling that we do. So it's a helpful tool, but it can only be part of it. And I wouldn't use it as a standalone reason why the Scottish Child Payment is working. But again, it was well evidenced, the modelling, but it came with its own health warnings that we would agree with.
And we had a long debate last week about, well, not a long debate, but we had a discussion about keeping versus lifting and the relevance of the poverty line. I mean, did you have a view on that in terms of the terminology that's used?
Well, I think the terminology used to talk about the poverty line seemed to be arbitrary. So the poverty line is arbitrary, I suppose, in a technical sense, yes, that is right. But I think what we've got with the Scottish Child Payment is a kind of highly effective targeting, which is just above as well as below the poverty line. And I think that is an actual benefit of the Scottish Child Payment, that it does that. Because those people who are just above the poverty line, they're not living on high incomes. It's still targeting low-income families. And I think in terms of keeping people out of poverty, I think, as Stephen mentioned, you know, the economic climate that we're in, low-income families are most susceptible to the buffers of high inflation and high costs. And I think that should be celebrated, that if it's keeping people out of poverty as well as lifting people out of poverty.
Sorry to interrupt, just before you go on, I believe Jeremy wanted to come in with a quick supplementary.
Sorry, Paul. Good morning, panel, and welcome. Thank you for coming. I appreciate it's early days, and we may not have this information yet, but from your talking to people, do we know where the money is being spent? So is it being spent on general family requirements, or is it being spent specifically on children and the care, the help that they require?
So in our kind of research for the mini inquiry here, when we spoke to parents about this, I think it's the context of when it was introduced and during the cost of living, the height of the cost of living crisis, it meant that it gave whole families breathing space. So it meant that the heating bills were able to be paid and that they could afford enough food to eat. But it also, like I think Ruth pointed this, it gave families that slight glimpse of a life that they had before the cost of living crisis. We had one participant talk about Friday night pizza night, which got able to be reintroduced back into the home. Now, this is them going to Morrison's and getting pizzas and being able to watch a film because of the child poverty, the Scottish Child Payment. That is exactly the kind of thing I think the Scottish Child Payment should be celebrated for doing, giving back family time, increasing well-being, and really just relieving the pressure on families who are under incredible strain at the moment.
Okay. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, convener. Other panel members may want to reflect on the data point, but I think just in the interest of time as well, we're also very keen to understand the impact on deep and persistent poverty and the extent to which the Scottish Child Payment is having an impact there. And I wonder also, do we need to do more work on those specific families to understand the picture there? Ruth, I don't know if you maybe want to start.
Yeah, of course. Thank you. So we'd absolutely echo what Jack had said there. So the latest poverty and inequality statistics don't yet show the full impact of the £25 Scottish Child Payment, so it's too soon to make conclusions about that. I think we did expect to see more of an impact in this data release, and that's partly because of the modelling that you mentioned from the Scottish Government, but also from think tanks in Scotland about what we expected the impact of the Scottish Child Payment to be. So that's why we've said in our submission that it's somewhat confusing trying to put all of that data together. But obviously we know, as I've mentioned, things like the time lag have an impact there. On deep poverty, I think that's a really important thing that was discussed in the panel last week. So it may not be getting people over that poverty line, but there is value in alleviating the depth of poverty that people are experiencing. So enabling them to pay for those essentials that otherwise they wouldn't be able to do. But all routes lead back to the data question. And obviously within the data that we have, it's very hard to disaggregate it by those income bands or to be able to look at the impact on deep or persistent poverty. And I think some of the evidence that was given last week and some of the potential research that might be done in that space, we would be really interested in that, particularly when we see a growing trend across the UK for destitution and deep poverty. Also, just to come back on Jeremy Balfour's question as well, I think that distinction of where money is being spent can sometimes be unhelpful, in the sense that if the money is going on essentials like food for the house or heating, there is still a direct benefit to the children in terms of growing up in a warm house, having access to the food that is required. But we do see from our work with parents that it was parents' intention, their ambition, that they would be using that payment for treats for children, for saving for their children's future. But because of the cost of living crisis, as Jack has highlighted, that money's then having to be put into household budgets. It's then part of their household budget. It's needed for their immediate needs like food, like heating. And we've seen parents having a degree of guilt about that, because they simply need that money to make ends meet, rather than feeling like they can put that directly into things that they would want to buy for their children. So I think we should be clear that there is a direct impact on children from that spend being in the household budget, but I don't think that should be the extent of our ambition for the Scottish Child Payment. It shouldn't just be about enabling people to get by. I think we all want more than that for children in Scotland.
Can I just a couple of brief points on both issues? First of all, the data issue. Yes, modelling definitely has its place. It has to be supplemented with actual, well, hard data, survey data, but it allows scenario planning and it allows us to consider and compare different options and consider counterfactuals. It can be supplemented by local data. I know that the committee was given evidence last week about using administrative data, and we do have some good development work underway in Scotland, led by the Improvement Service and Public Health Scotland, and Glasgow Community Planning Partnership, for example, have worked with the Centre for Civic Innovation to get a very good detailed profile at the local level of the distribution of poverty and the different households who are particularly vulnerable to it. That takes me to a point of depth and effectiveness. My colleague, also on the Commission, Professor Suzanne Fitzpatrick, and her colleagues at Heriot-Watt University, have really done a lot of work on destitution, actually funded by Joseph Rowntree Foundation. The Scottish Child Payment does contribute to that. The groups who are most vulnerable to extreme poverty and destitution are often people, well, single males, for example, of working age. They are not targeted by the Scottish Child Payment. But they overlap with the group who we think should be considered for the Scottish Child Payment, which are asylum seekers, refugees, and those without recourse to public funds. There are technical and perhaps even legal and jurisdictional challenges for the Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament about that. But that came out as a group from the workshops that the Poverty and Equality Commission conducted that could be better served by the Scottish Child Payment. However, it is effectively targeted. The six family households who make up 90% of children in poverty are well served by the Scottish Child Payment. So again, if we think about counterfactuals, we'd need to think about what would be the case if this didn't exist? What would people be experiencing? What would they not be able to afford? Which relates to Mr. Balfour's point about where the money goes. Much of it now is sadly going on essentials, but if it wasn't there, those essentials would not be in place, and the depth and intensity of poverty would be much greater for households.
Thank you, Kevin.
I'll bring Bob in a minute as a supplementary, but just a quick comment on the back of what Jeremy asked about where the money goes. You're probably aware that there was some modelling carried out by the Trussell Trust in terms of the Scottish Payment, and if there's seen an impact on our reduction in terms of food parcels. And one of the things that came out of that was that a lot of families were actually using the Scottish Child Payment to pay off debt. Is that something that use here as well, that they're using it to pay off debt?
Seen the modelling and the work from Trussell Trust and the Fraser of Allender, I would well believe that that's what the Scottish Child Payment is having to be used for in certain households, because one of the consequences of a prolonged cost of living crisis is that families have had to enter deeper debt or are struggling to pay off their debt. That was one of the findings of our work with the Scottish Women's Budget Group into the impact of the cost of living crisis, that women were really struggling to pay off existing debts and were therefore are at risk of falling into greater debt. So when that Scottish Child Payment is being taken as part of an overall household budget, that's an essential cost, is paying off debt for those households. So I would expect that that would be the case. And we really welcomed the recommendations from the Trussell Trust work that there's more that the Scottish Child Payment could be doing to prevent families with children needing to use charitable food aid. So their call for the payment to increase to £40. And I think that would have an even bigger impact on families' finances and hopefully prevent them falling into debt in the first place.
Okay, thanks, Ruth. Now bring in Bob. Thank you.
Thank you, Camilla. Good morning, everyone. It's just a very brief question, probably for Stephen Sinclair, because he was talking about counterfactuals. And all three witnesses have spoken about last week's evidence about the need for better data. And one of the suggestions we heard from witnesses last week was the need to do a comparative study in relation to the experience in Scotland, but also other parts of the UK. And that could help with some of the counterfactuals. So, and I made the point last week about I represent Maryhill. So what is the lived experience of families in poverty in Maryhill comparative to, say, Merseyside? And that way you can analyse what difference the Scottish Child Payment has or hasn't made, or indeed any actions in Merseyside that is meant to tackle child poverty. So do the witnesses, Stephen Sinclair in particular, have a view in relation to whether that comparative study would be helpful?
Yes, undoubtedly. I know some of the team who are working on that and the Changing Realities project. I think that they'll be hoping that some of the evidence they gather will be used to persuade the UK government to either increase child benefit or introduce something like the Scottish Child Payment. But irrespective of that, I think that sort of research will provide two sources of information which we don't have in the full picture that we'd like. One would be the effectiveness of delivery, the experience of delivery. I know that there's been testimony given to the committee on that, and it's that this Social Security Scotland are considered a much better provider of services than some of their more long-standing UK counterparts, but there are still issues of uptake which could be addressed and improved, and also issues of the committee have asked about the use of the payment. If we can engage with families in receipt of Scottish Child Payment, we can see the extent to which it is being spent on core essentials and the extent to which it is enabling children to participate in other activities. We don't have a full picture on that yet, so more data would certainly be very useful.
Very helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So moving on to theme two, which is the impact on individual families, I'm going to invite Ros McCollin. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you very much for joining us. We've already touched on this, actually, with some of the interventions and some of the questions that have come, because we've taken a lot of evidence on, certainly last week, on what the Scottish Child Payment is being used for. So it's really that I want to sort of delve into a little bit more information on. So how has the impact of the Scottish Child Payment been affected by the broader economic and social security context? Now, of course, we have already dealt with that on a sort of level, but can you give me a little bit more information? And I'm happy to just to go down the panel. So, Jack, if you'd like to start with yourself, and then we'll work our way along.
As I said earlier, the context of which the Scottish Child Payment has been paid in is severe. Like, parents are cutting back on essentials. Our research shows 4 in 5 people in receipt of Scottish Child Payment have been cutting back on essentials, so like food. We also know people are getting further into debt, and we know that they've just come out of a pandemic where their financial security has been eroded. Their savings are very low. They have very little wiggle room to deal with the kind of day-to-day things that might happen. Your washing machine breaks down, your car breaks down, you lose your bus pass. So all that means is that when the Scottish Child Payment is paid, it feels very good for the families, and it's very effective at relieving some of that pressure, but it might not be getting spent on what they had originally thought it would be spent on, like making your family more enjoyable to be in, to kind of get those days out, to kind of replace clothes quicker than they currently are. So that's the kind of economic context. And then in the policy context, I think it's unavoidable that JRF would suggest that the social security system at a UK level is way below what it needs to be. It doesn't relate to what families need. It is not connected in any way to the reality of the current costs. And our suggestion would be that you need to tie much more closely the social security level of universal credit to the reality of what parents are facing. Without that, the Scottish Child Payment while of course very welcome and really effective, its effectiveness is limited by both of those things, by the economic context and the social security context.
Okay, thank you. Ruth?
Would absolutely echo what Jack said, that we need to put it in the context of the broader UK system, and we know that we all rely on a strong social safety net that's there when we need it. That's a vital lifeline for people. But right now, the UK system is actually pulling people into poverty, and we see that 90% of people who are in receipt of universal credit are going without essentials, and that's why we've supported Joseph Rowntree Foundation and the Trussell Trust campaign around the essentials guarantee. When we look at the Scottish child payment, like any income, it has been impacted by the rising cost crisis that we reside in. So I think what Professor Danny Dorling said last week about it being about enabling people to stay still rather than sink, that obviously isn't the objective of the policy. We wanted it to be broader than that. But a parent told Save the Children that they don't feel like they're getting the full impact of the Scottish Child Payment now because they're having to cut back on so many things. So it's just about a household budget being able to maintain solid rather than being able to build upon that and feel like you've got that extra wriggle room that we've all spoken about today. And as I said, we've had parents in our Serving the Future research tell us that their dream for that payment, what they wanted to do with it, is just not possible in the context of the current cost crisis. So there's definitely something about how our political leaders make sure that our social security system keeps pace with the real cost of living, that we make sure that we're increasing that payment so that families can maximise the potential of that extra income.
Okay, thank you. Stephen?
The Scottish Child Payment is providing an essential lifeline in two aspects of the wider context. So we have an economy which is making lots of people poor. We have low-paid jobs with irregular hours, which people cannot sustain raising a family on. That is a much wider macroeconomic problem. We may attribute blame to the UK government for that, but irrespective of that, one area where they do have responsibility, which is also worsening the situation with it, Scottish Child Payment is partially addressing, is, as Jack and Ruth have said and other testimonies provided, is an inadequate benefit system and punitive and egregious policies such as the cap, the benefit cap and the two-child limit. Where we have underfunded Social Security with those sorts of conditions, the Scottish Child Payment can only go so far and partly redressing that. For example, Fran Bennett and Jane Miller have calculated that child benefit has lost about 20% of its value since 2010. Now, that can be addressed in part, but we basically need a benefit system which provides security in a world in which most people, or a very significant section of society, are a paycheck or two paychecks away from being in very deep vulnerability to poverty.
Thank you very much. My next question. To what extent does the Scottish Child Payment have an impact beyond purely financial? And how important are these wider impacts? And again, we'll go back down the other way this time, if that's okay. Steve, we'll start with yourself.
The Scottish Child Payment is part of the Social Security system, and Social Security system provides an investment in our children and in our future. The reason we have it is not just because of solidarity and moral reasons. It's functional economically. We pay many of the costs of child poverty in other areas, such as health, such as the criminal justice system, such as people not having jobs which pay enough in which they can pay tax. If we can prevent that by a decent platform, a minimum income guarantee, a social security system which addresses the deprivations of child poverty, then it can be a very effective prophylactic. It can be an investment in a more productive economic sector in the future. So that's the wider impact. Again, we have to consider what would be the case if we didn't have it. We didn't have the Scottish Child Payment, we didn't have Social Security. We would not have a productive economy, and we would have a very divisive and unhappy society. So we need to consider Scottish Child Payment as a very significant contribution to those sorts of preventative interventions.
Okay, thank you. Ruth?
we definitely see a wider impact, and we know that financial insecurity is closely tied to poor mental health. That's been particularly pertinent during the cost of living crisis, where parents have been telling us about the stress and anxiety that come with trying to stretch household budgets that just simply don't have any further stretch. Mental Health Foundation have done work in Scotland that's shown that the cost of living crisis is impacting people's quality of sleep and their health as a result of that stress. And something I heard at the Poverty in Scotland launch in 2022 really stuck with me, where a parent had said that she worries about her children having growth spurts because she knows that she doesn't have the income to pay for that additional food. And these are milestones in your children's life that should be something that you're celebrating, but rather it's become a source of anxiety for people. So we know that when households have additional income, that alleviates that stress, it alleviates that anxiety, and that is a positive thing. There's also benefits for your health in terms of being able to afford healthy and nutritious food, being able to put your heating on. And also we've heard during the cost of living crisis that people quite simply can't afford the price of a bus fare to attend medical appointments. So giving that extra income to the house definitely has those broader mental health and physical health impacts. I think in the Citizens Advice submission, they'd mentioned Sure Start centres, and I think there's actually some comparators there. So you could measure the impact of Sure Start purely on whether it shifted the poverty dial, but we know there was broader impacts in terms of educational attainment, health outcomes and parental outcomes. And there's a range of outcomes that sit behind the Scottish Child Payment, and I think we need to look at the impact across all of those outcomes to get a really clear picture of the benefits for families. But certainly from our qualitative work with families, we absolutely see broader impacts beyond the financial alone.
Thank you, Ruth. And Jack, your final point.
I would agree with what both my colleagues have said. The only other point I'd make about the Scottish Child Payment appears to be making our society more equal. It seems to be having a great impact on how close the wages are along the income distribution. And I think that, alongside reducing poverty, is something that's been missing perhaps in previous policy around reducing child poverty. And it's really good to see both those things happening in the same time, because a more equal economy or a more equal society is a benefit to everyone.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Moving on to theme three, which is extending eligibility, I'm going to invite Marie McNairdon. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for your time this morning. I'm covering on the issue of extending eligibility, and it's been briefly touched on, so I'm looking to get your views on which changes to eligibility would have the greatest impact on reducing poverty. And I'll start with Jack.
I don't think I have a big answer on this. I think in terms of the biggest impact, I'm not sure, but I think for the deepest impact, I think what's been brought up before is that those people with no recourse to public funds are in some of the most difficult circumstances, and they are not eligible for the Scottish Child Payment for legislative and perhaps legal reasons. So I would say that is a cohort I'd be extremely interested to look at, but other than that...
Ruth, do you want to share?
Yeah, so we're really excited about the prospects of moving the Scottish Child Payment to being a standalone benefit in terms of childhood assistance, and we see that as being an interim step towards the implementation of a minimum income guarantee, and it does give us some scope to change eligibility. I think when we're thinking about what would have the biggest impact, certainly no recourse, people with no recourse to public funds, so people in the asylum system, would be very near the top of the list. So right now we see that people in the asylum system are living off around £48 per week. If you're in a hotel, you're living off around £9. So the idea of having an additional £25 a week on top of that income would be transformational. And obviously we see people who have no recourse to public funds living in very dire situations in terms of that deep and poverty and destitution that we've talked about. Another area that's come up in our work with parents, but also in the work with our members, is around transitions and schools. So right now you have that eligibility up to 16. We know that for some parents there's a conflict between wanting your child to stay in school beyond 16, but knowing that you'll lose the financial support for that child. So here we see the overlap between multiple policy priorities. So we have policies that we want around the attainment gap, but here we almost see the undermining of that ambition because parents quite simply can't afford for their children to stay in school beyond 16. So we would be really interested in how you could extend eligibility up to 18 for people that are in full-time non-advanced education, or how there could be a taper that comes in at 16 to the age of 19. So I think those would be two areas we would highlight. There's also things around people who are in receipt of maternity allowance, students who lose out because of student income, and also for families who are in temporary accommodation where their housing support is paid through housing benefit rather than the housing element of universal credit, and because housing benefit isn't a qualifying benefit, lose out on that additional support. So I think there's a range of options. I think no recourse to public funds and over the age of 16 are the priorities that we're hearing from our membership, so we'd raise those as priorities today.
That's really helpful. Stephen, you've obviously touched on it earlier on, so I don't think you want to come back in. Ruth, in your submission, obviously, and you've mentioned it there, you suggest the Scottish Chamberlain could be a building block of minimum income guarantee. In what ways could the minimum income guarantee have a greater impact on child poverty than the Scottish Child Payment?
Yes, so the minimum income guarantee is the idea of setting this solid income floor below which nobody in Scotland would be allowed to fall. That's achieved by complementary parts. So we need changes to social security, but we also need changes to the world of work so that more people can reach that income level through fair work. We also need changes to our public services so that we reduce the cost of living for low-income households. So in that way, it's a more expansive policy than the Scottish Child Payment. The Scottish Government have committed to the minimum income guarantee. We really welcome that. It's important to say it was also in other party manifestos ahead of the 2021 Scottish Parliament election. The Scottish Government have established an expert group to take forward that commitment, and in their interim report, which was published in March of last year, they put forward a range of policies that could pave the way to a minimum income guarantee, lay those foundations, and one of those was the Scottish Child Payment, and in particular altering the legislative footing so that you've got that power to taper, you've got the power to change the award for certain groups who maybe need some extra support, and also to avoid those cliff edges in support. So that's been endorsed by our membership at engagement sessions we've had on the minimum income guarantee, and also in the Short Life Working Group that we're hosting as part of our Challenge Poverty Week policy asks. I think when we think about the Scottish Child Payment as an interim step towards MIG, the options are twofold. So it is about how we have that standalone childhood assistance benefit, but it's also about the level of the minimum income guarantee. So a £40 Scottish Child Payment would bring you closer to that minimum income guarantee level. I think we should avoid seeing it as an either-or, because the Scottish Child Payment is that interim step, but also MIG simply builds on the principles that underpin the Scottish Child Payment. So it's about adequacy, it's about decency, it's a practical proposal to realise our fundamental human rights. It does have the impact on child poverty, but MIG would also broaden our impact on poverty in that it gives us the potential to tackle single adult poverty or disabled people's poverty, which we know there's increasing concern around. So the MIG is a building on the Scottish Child Payment. We should see it as a step towards MIG. But in the whole, MIG obviously gives us more potential in the terms of it's across those three spheres of activity.
Thank you. I wait with interest. The MIG report coming out later. Jack, do you want to kind of come in, or is it covered, Stephen?
Just to echo Ruth's point, that I know this is an inquiry into the Scottish Child Payment, and that's important, but it has to be seen in this wider context. We don't want to just focus exclusively on Social Security, let alone just one form of Social Security. It has to be part of a package of activity, particularly if we're going to meet the 2030 child poverty targets.
Can do that back to yourself.
Okay, thanks very much. I believe Jeremy wanted to come in on a supplementary. No, you don't. Okay, anyway, moving on to theme four, which is increasing the Scottish Child Payment weekly amount. I believe I'm going to invite Jeremy in now. Thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if I can just go back. You don't want to cause confusion, but terminology and words do matter. And the reason I ask a question about how would the money been spent is if you were starting again, is Scottish Child Payment actually a good terminology to use in regard to it can make parents feel guilty for not spending the money on their children rather than spending it on what obviously the children benefit from, heating and food. I'm just wondering, would you call it something different? Probably we wouldn't want to go back now because it just caused too much confusion. But as a philosophical issue, is it the right name? Ruth, you're smiling, so I'll pick on you first.
Didn't expect this question. I think when we're talking about moving to a standalone benefit, actually the terminology of childhood assistance probably does better reflect the range of impacts that we have all highlighted today and were highlighted in last week's panel and also in the wider written submissions. I think the calling it assistance and a payment is really important because, as you've said, the language really does matter, and we know that when we are calling things benefits, that comes with a sense of stigma in terms of accessing that support. So I think keeping the sense of assistance and payment is really important, but your point is probably a fair one in terms of the Scottish Child Payment. Perhaps that terminology does give rise to the guilt that I've mentioned from some of our research, and childhood assistance may be a more accurate term for the range of benefits that we've seen from that support.
Well, I mean, Scottish Child Payment, in a sense, was brought in partly to redress the inadequacy of child benefit. Child benefit recognises that children are a considerable cost to parents, but a considerable asset to society, and we all need to support the families and adults of the future. So we're not particularly interested or hung up on the terminology. What we think that social security is a positive phrase rather than, for example, welfare, because that comes with more negative baggage. But what you wish to call it is of less importance than its value and its effectiveness.
I suppose in the list of things I'm concerned about with social security, the name is not up there, and also what it's been spent on is not up there. On the latter point, it's because I trust families can budget better than the government can budget for them. They know what they need to spend their money on. They manage extremely tight finances and extremely difficult economic headwinds. So the idea that the £40 or the £26.70 needs to be spent on kids' shoes and as compared to the fuel bill or the mum or dad getting to work, I think we just leave that to families. I think cash transfers work. They make a big impact for the families, and they should be the ones that are deciding how it's used. And again, with the name, I understand the points that I completely agree with social security, welfare, benefits kind of conversation. But again, it's an incredibly effective policy, and the name of it hasn't come up once with anyone that we've spoken to in receipt of it. So that's where
That is very helpful. Okay, let me start the bidding war with Jack and then working down the line. What should the Scottish Child Payment be, figure-wise, and give me a justification for the figure?
Okay. So we have called for the Scottish Child Payment to raise in line to what the former First Minister committed to. So he said that it was going to move to £30, and it hasn't. So that's where our kind of starting bid would be. I think what depends on future increases is how it interacts with other policies. We need effective labour market and fair work policy to ensure that social security is less relied upon. And then in future, hopefully, we don't need to keep pushing up social security payments and families are able to earn their income for themselves. But I think the justification for increasing Scottish Child Payment is evident in the modelling. So if it were, for example, to increase to £40, that you get an additional 20,000 children out of poverty. These are choices that I think are the right ones to be talking about. And I think if you're weighing up where money is spent and how cost-effective a policy it is, I think that's one of the Scottish Child Payment's greatest strengths. So if, for example, if you were to compare the £140 million that was spent on freezing council tax, as opposed to perhaps putting that into Scottish Child Payment increases, council tax freeze benefits families roughly in low incomes 50 pence a week. Scottish Child Payment increase with the same rate, £140 million, you lift 10,000 children out of poverty. I think it's quite clear that increasing Scottish Child Payment is needed and it is effective. But at the moment, we've said £30, but also happy to support others.
So the Poverty Alliance is part of the End Child Poverty Coalition in Scotland, and one of our core collective calls is for the Scottish Child Payment to reach £40. That's a call that has been made across the anti-poverty sector as well. And that's not a figure that's just been plucked out of the air, but rather a figure that modelling tells us is required to meet those interim child poverty targets and make progress towards those 2030 targets. We've seen in the Trussell Trust and Fraser O'Vallander research that the convener mentioned there that they're calling for the Scottish Child Payment to reach £40, because right now their evidence shows that at its current rate, the payment's not yet doing enough to prevent households with children having to access charitable food aid. I think we should be clear, as Jack has said there, that we need to put the Scottish Child Payment in the broader context of anti-poverty policy making. And right now we're so reliant on the Scottish Child Payment, it's doing most of the heavy lifting to get us even in the position where we might meet the child poverty targets. When we look at Best Start, Bright Futures, we see a clear implementation gap across some of the broader areas where change is needed. So that's things like parental employability and childcare, which we know are absolutely critical to meeting the child poverty targets and lifting children out of poverty. So the further increases in the Scottish Child Payment should be put into the context of the fact that we need investment in those broader policy areas as well. And this is ultimately a question of our political choices and where we want to prioritise the funding that we currently have. We've welcomed the stipulation from the new First Minister that his ambition is to eradicate child poverty. We think that's the right ambition, that's the right priority, and we think that increasing the Scottish Child Payment to £40 would be a really positive way to start that journey to eradication.
The Poverty and Equality Commission have not expressed an opinion on the specific value, the sum of Scottish Child Payment. Our argument is that the amount that it should be depends on its effectiveness and other options. It is, at the moment, the most direct and quickest way to reduce child poverty. However, there are three drivers of poverty which are diagnosed by the Scottish Government in Every Child, Every Chance and Best Start, Bright Futures. And we think it's, as Ruth and Jack have said, we need action on all of these. Our argument in previous scrutiny reports is that unless the Scottish Government can point to other ways in which it can make a significant contribution to reducing child poverty, we are going to have to rely on Social Security. But that's not a justification for just doing that. What that means is we should be looking at action in the other two areas, reducing household costs, increasing income for employment. And there are good measures already being introduced and implemented by the Scottish Government, but we don't think they're of the scale and impact that they need to be at the moment. So in absence of anything else, Scottish Child Payment is the big hitter. And we would never argue for not increasing it, but we think that it has to be in step with other significant changes.
That's helpful, thank you. So the other side of the coin is it's got to be paid for. If Scottish Government are here, they'll tell you they've got a fixed budget. We have a £1.2 billion deficit within Social Security benefits in 2 years' time. So if I can start with Ruth, because Stephen may not want to answer us, which other budget are you going to take that money from? Is it health? Is it education? Is it transport? Which budget is less deserving than this budget?
Well, we have done work with IPPR Scotland and Oxfam looking at options around tax powers and how we can raise the revenue that's needed for our national priorities. I think the key takeaway from that paper is that we have presented the Scottish Government with a range of options and we need to look seriously at those options. We know that better tax builds better budgets, which ultimately builds a better future for all of us. And the transformational change that we're all calling for today requires transformational investment, and you've quite rightly identified that there have been quite stark warnings about the future sustainability of Scotland's finances, and we need to be clear that that's just about standing still. That's not even about the further investment that this government or future governments might want to put into their own priorities. So I think we need our political leaders to look seriously at that range of tax options. So We've called for a cross-party process to reform our system of council tax, which is long overdue. We've welcomed the changes to income tax. Is there more that can be done in that space? And we'll really be looking to the tax strategy that will be published in the coming months from the advisory group to see if there's options that can be adopted. But I think, as we've all said here today, this is ultimately about how we prioritise our budget. As Jack said, we had £147 million applied to a council tax freeze that did absolutely nothing to progress the Scottish Government's core aim of tackling child poverty. In CPAG's written submission, they have some evidence from their cost of the school day network, where children have said, give us more money so that everyone has a fair chance, give us more money so that we can go on school trips. And I think when we hear that coming from children, it sounds really simple. And ultimately, that's because it is. And we can take that lived experience evidence and put it into contact with the idea of a fixed budget or the idea of a tight fiscal environment. But this is ultimately a question about the type of Scotland that we want to be, and can we justify a situation where almost a quarter of our children are living in poverty? And I don't think that we can in a wealthy country like Scotland. So we would look to our tax powers and also looking at how we prioritise the resources that we currently have.
Jack, you mentioned council tax. I don't know if you want to add anything beyond
that. No, I just agree. I think that reconciling the fiscal reality with the policy imperative is not to be underestimated, and I don't take that flippantly in any way. But I think that's the questions that the Parliament has committed to, this child poverty targets. It's the Parliament that needs to have those incredibly difficult and important conversations about where resources are most effectively spent. And we know that the Scottish Child Payment is an incredibly effective policy. So yes, it's about raising money, but I suppose it's also about scrutiny on other parts of budgets and what we prioritise at a time when money is tight.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. Continuing on with that theme as well, I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Hey, thank you. Yes, I mean, Jeremy Balfour asked you about increasing the Scottish Child Payment right across the board, but another suggestion has been that we should target it more at those in greatest need, for example, those in severe poverty or perhaps in rural areas where there can be extra expenses. So have you any thoughts about that? I don't mind who starts. Mr Sinclair.
One of the virtues of the Scottish Child Payment is its simplicity. It's administratively not complex. There's a good understanding amongst those who receive it. It's quite cheap, relatively speaking, to deliver. There may be a case for recognising the additional costs of families with a disabled member and the rural premium. The Commission does not have a particular view on that. Anything that can help families, we're in favour of, but we would like to see if that's going to be at the expense of other families who are also suffering. One issue for your consideration is that our experience panel, who support the work of the Commission, have pointed out that it costs considerably more to raise a child in their early teens than it costs to raise a child who is, you know, 6, 7 or so on there. They're just simply more expensive. The Scottish Child Payment does not give due consideration to that. And it might be something that the committee wants to look at, whether or not that would be an issue that's worth addressing.
But I suppose, Mr Evans, anything you do like that, it complicates things, doesn't it? And people then have to start filling in forms, and they have to be assessed, and disability, you know, where do we draw the line, and what age would we draw the line, and all of these kind of things. So is it better to have just a simple system, or should we be targeting a bit more?
So I think this Social Security Scotland should be congratulated for having made applying for the Scottish Child Payment really quite good. So, I mean, I would probably trust them to deal with complexity if it balanced out with impact. And I think if you're looking at specific groups to target, I think the justification I'd be looking at is depth of poverty and maybe labour market interaction. And I think that would probably mean that you'd maybe think about, if you were looking at increasing for certain groups, and priority groups is where my framing would be at, would be families with babies. You know, they've got a higher proportion of a higher chance of going into poverty once you have a baby in the family. It's also a time at families' lives when, with statutory maternity policy being an ineffective income replacement policy, good like labour market retention policy, keeps people in work, but the money isn't enough. That seems like a moment in people's lives and families' lives that we should be amping up support, so I'd be interested to look at that. And then the other one, and I suppose it's quite a maths, it's just a simple arithmetic, is for single parent households. I think we've become so far in the economy now that we kind of, it doesn't feel like you can have a household, very hard to have a household without two incomes. And if that isn't the case, then I think we need to look at ways that we can support single income households better. But as you say, you could probably make a great case for each of the priority groups, and the five priority groups represent 80% of all the children in poverty in Scotland, because then you could look at minority ethnic communities where the poverty rate is double that of the national average. So I think it is the right question to be asking. I think the justification needs to be really strong, but I wouldn't be put off by the complexity of it. Like, that wouldn't be the reason not to look at it. I just think there's quite a lot of places it could go. And I suppose the final thing is, where is there other policies that interact that could support other families specifically? So we kind of touched on employability. Parental Employment Support, or Parental Employment Support Fund, which was cut from Best Starts Bright Futures a couple of years ago, was supposed to target these family employment support because they have quite unique needs in the labour market or need different types of support. Without that being in there, like, that then puts further pressure on the Scottish Child Payment to support those priority groups.
If you take babies, for example, there is some one-off support for having a baby, isn't there?
Yeah, of course, and you get different. Your employer plays a role in that as well. There's much more generous employment support, but I still think the data tells us that having a baby is one of the things that heightens your risk of being in poverty if you're a low-income family. It is one of those like crunch points that then you could then fall into further debt. You know, you could end up preventing poverty further down the line by making sure that the start of the child's life is most effective, okay, is supported in the most effective ways.
Right, Ms Boyle, I mean, Mr Evans is very relaxed about a complicated system, but we've already had suggestions of targeting disabled children, rural, teenagers, babies, single parents, minority ethnic. Doesn't it just become horribly complicated, or do you think that is the way to go, a bit more targeting?
I think we have definitely seen feedback from the people we work with that they've welcomed the simplicity of the application process, particularly in contrast with what they've experienced at UK level. So as we move to a standalone benefit, it's really important that the simplicity of those application processes are maintained. But as I said, in the context of the minimum income guarantee, moving to a standalone benefit does give us opportunities to tailor, to give a little bit additional support to certain households, and I think that's something that we should definitely look at in the context of the implementation of that standalone benefit. I think rural is an interesting issue. So the Poverty Alliance provide the secretariat to the cross-party group on poverty, to which Paul O'Kane is the convener. And we recently published a report into rural poverty. And one of the findings was the lower uptake of social security in rural areas, coupled with the fact that the cost of living is around 15 to 30% higher. And there were questions whether our social security system has taken that rural premium into account. But definitely, I think a key place to start on the rural issue is thinking about how we can encourage better uptake. So the Scottish Government's own evidence shows that uptake of the Scottish Child Payment is lower in areas like Moray, like Highland and Aberdeenshire. So an initial step to addressing that rural premium is definitely thinking about how we can encourage benefit uptake in rural issues. I think to add to the already extensive list, one of our members, One Parent Family Scotland, have also looked at how you could mitigate the young parent penalty and universal credit through the Scottish Child Payment, so by increasing the payment to parents who are under 25. So I will also throw that option into the ring. But we wouldn't have a priority right now in terms of tailoring, but definitely as we implement a Scottish Child Payment as a standalone benefit, and also as we look to implement a minimum income guarantee, that question of tailoring is going to be really pertinent and something that should be consulted on and considered.
Okay. I mean, maybe I'll let some of my colleagues will follow up on this, but I'm interested that when we've got a simple system at the moment, it's one figure across the board, that still the uptake's quite low. And I think my gut feeling is if we complicate it more, that might hit the uptake. But I'll leave that one just now. I mean, tapering's the other question, if I can stay with yourself. Again, complicates it if people have the payment is to be reduced as people's income increases, and it means people have to feed in information, or the employers do, or all of that. And yet there's a kind of fairness about tapering that it prevents this cliff edge idea that people just lose everything all at one go. Thoughts on that?
You continue on. Can I just remind everyone that we're tight for time at the moment, and to try and make your responses as concise as possible. Thank you.
No problem. If I could just come back on your point first about the uptake, I think to be clear, the uptake of the Scottish Child Payment is very good across the board. It's just that there is a lower uptake in those three local authorities that I mentioned, but we don't have any issues in terms of highlighting the uptake as being a concern across the board. On the taper, I think what we heard last week about the fact that there currently isn't a taper around the Scottish Child Payment when you enter work is actually a good work incentive, but obviously as the Scottish Child Payment hopefully continues to increase, the question of tapering becomes more pertinent. And in the Poverty and Inequality Commission's evidence, we've seen issues with parents highlighting those cliff edges and people trying to maintain at least £1 of universal credit income to make sure that they keep that Scottish Child Payment. And that's going to be particularly important for women who are more likely to take time out of the labour market to care for children, account for 92% of single parents, and are often the majority of so-called second earners in the home. So I think we need to make sure that we're getting that right from a gender equality perspective as well. I think last week we heard there's no ready-made model of tapering that we can take off the shelf and apply to the Scottish Child Payment. It requires a lot of thought to make sure that we don't have any unintended consequences. So our stance would be that that's something that should be consulted on, particularly as we move to a standalone benefit. And critically, we need to centre the voices of people who are in receipt of universal credit and in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment. It's really important that we make sure that we're hearing from people directly about how a taper could work for them and how we can avoid any unintended consequences.
Mr. Sinclair?
I don't have anything to add to that.
Well done. Mr. Evans?
Nope.
OK, convener.
OK, that's lovely. Thank you very much. And moving on to theme five is the cost and value for money. And I'm going to invite Katie Clark in. Thank you.
Thank you. And the Scottish Child Payment is forecast to rise in cost from £457 million to £492 million. And Jack has already spoken about the need for prioritisation. So do the witnesses think that the Scottish Child Payment justifies its cost? The witnesses that we've heard in previous sessions have very much been of the view that it does. And do you think, out of the range of policies that are intended to address poverty, money is better put into increasing the Scottish Child Payment, or perhaps another initiative such as childcare, employability, or the raft of anti-poverty initiatives that potentially could be possible? And I'll go to Jack first.
So the first quick answer is yes, it just justifies its cost and it's an effective policy. In terms of the trade-offs with other, I think we probably need to so you've talked about childcare and employability as specific policies. I would probably question why it would just be in that budget that we'd be looking at, and other budgets are available as well. I think childcare is clearly supports the reduction of poverty, but also the prevention of poverty. So the childcare system that we have right now of early learning and childcare, children are getting a great start in life, and I think that can't be underestimated. But it's poverty reduction, as in allowing people to get into work, is probably, if you were to stack that up against the Scottish Child Payment, it wouldn't look as effectively targeted, because it's a universal offer open to everyone. So the £1 billion a year spent on early learning childcare funded hours for 1140 wouldn't be as an effective poverty reduction tool as Scottish Child Payment, but it's not meant to be. It's meant to increase family wellbeing, it's meant to reduce poverty, and it's meant to prevent poverty. And in that sense, that's probably doing the right thing.
If you were to focus on initiatives that you think are more targeted at poverty, do you think Scottish Child Payment is the kind of approach, that kind of direct payment, is more effective?
Lessons from the Scottish Child Payment are that targeting is extremely effective. So when looking at expansion of other areas or how we're going to refine policy in other areas, for example, childcare, you should take the lessons and the first expansion should always be targeted at low-income families. So if we're going to extend from 1140 for funded childcare hours, we need to start with the low-income families, because that is where you'll get the most impact on your poverty reduction. But it will also not show up in poverty reduction in some ways because of the way that relative poverty is calculated, because it just childcare costs aren't part of your of the poverty calculation. But what it will do is significantly increase families' disposable income, and that is an extremely laudable aim of any policy.
I mean, you, as you said earlier, it's a question of prioritisation. So if the choice was more money into the Scottish Child Payment or more money into targeted child care and other initiatives, where would you tend to fall?
Well, I think I'd be in a much different job if that was my decision to make.
For advice.
So I think the advice would be that you would look at the modelling and see what targeting you're having. I think the clear answer, though, is that the Scottish Child Payment alone will not get us to the 2030 child poverty targets and will not sustainably reduce child poverty to the levels that we all want. So we need to be able to operate at both speeds of reducing child poverty and preventing child poverty.
Okay. Thank you. Ruth?
We would absolutely say that the impact of the Scottish Child Payment justifies that investment. We're here today representing stories that have been given to us by parents who have kindly given up their time to speak to our organisations. And I think if those individuals and families were in front of you today, you would absolutely see the justified cost that goes into the Scottish Child Payment. I think I would agree with Jack in terms of it not being an either or. I think as an initial step, we would definitely say that further investment in the Scottish Child Payment to reach £40 is the critical starting point for addressing child poverty in Scotland. But we heard from Stephen earlier about those structural drivers of poverty. Professor Dorling highlighted that last week as well, about seeing the Scottish Child Payment as being this emergency response, but what is the structural changes that sit around that? So once we've reached that £40 Scottish Child Payment, it's really important that we're looking at Best Start Bright Futures and taking forward the actions that are in there, in particular around the labour market. The labour market has a critical role to play in any anti-poverty strategy, but right now we see that 70% of children who are in poverty live in a household where someone is in paid work, so it's not yet playing as big a part as it has to. So we would then be looking to the labour market and employability, and also the role of employers, where there's less of a cost to Scottish Government budgets, but employers have action to take to make sure that parents are not living in poverty.
Thank you.
I'd reiterate the fact that the Scottish Child Payment is proven to be cost-effective and impactful. In terms of difficult choices and trade-offs, I would say that we don't accept the Poverty and Equality Commission that it is an either-or, that one of the choices that we don't accept is that the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Government has placed financial and revenue constraints upon itself. So we published a report on taxation. There are still unused powers that the Scottish Government has. They have also requested additional powers in its 2022 medium-term financial strategy, which we hope will be reiterated. So we would argue that not only should local taxation be looked at to expand revenue, but there should also be consideration down the line to taxing unearned income and wealth. That means that would be a hard choice, but once we have that, the choices about how to help the most needy families and invest in our children will be a bit simpler.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Bob Dorison. Thanks.
Thanks, convener. Really interesting evidence session. Rewind just ever so slightly. Mr. Balfour said earlier about a deficit within Social Security in Scotland, I think, during the questioning. For clarity, there's not a deficit. What there is the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland spend £1.2 billion more in doing the right thing, protecting those vulnerable people in society, than they would have done had they stuck to UK Westminster policies. And that's the policy choices in Scotland, and that shouldn't be portrayed as a deficit. And I think that's really quite important to put on the record, given the exchange we're having with witnesses today about political priorities and policy choices. I've made that point now, convener. But we do have to make policy choices here in Scotland. Of course we do. And some of the questions I was going to ask have been mopped up a little bit by Mr. Mason in relation to targeting. But I'm conscious that if we put the Scottish Child Payment to £30, that would cost an additional £60 million, roughly, to do that. If we then increased it to £40, that would be £170 million on top of that again. So I think it's quite reasonable to ask, not about how we raise the revenue, but if this place, this Parliament, identifies £50 million, £100 million, £150 million, my goodness, Mr. Sinclair, I don't have any of this money available to me, I'm afraid. But if we did identify it, what would the best spend of that be? I know the answer is it's not either or, but our committee needs a steer when we do budget scrutiny in relation to these things. So Mr. Evans, I think, spoke about early years and children. We have Best Start Foods and the Best Start Grant. We could give a Scottish Child Payment Supplement for families in receipt of that suite of benefits, theoretically. We hopefully know the ages of young people who are getting the Scottish Child Payment, so we could have a supplement based on teenagers. Mr. Sinclair was perhaps suggesting that. Many families tell me it's most expensive around the summer, so I've suggested there could be a June payment, which is a double payment, which would be a summer supplement to help out at difficult times of the year. So there are lots of policy choices that the Scottish Government has to consider, and the witnesses we have here today are, you are experts whose opinions we value. So can I just try and twist your arms a little bit to see where you would target as and when money becomes available, Mr. Sinclair?
Well, at the moment, the testimony is overwhelming that Scottish Child Payment is effective and it's having the biggest impact. So I don't like to evade the question, but the question gets turned back on the Scottish Government, as I said. If they can point to other measures which are going to have the same level of impact within the same time frame, we would support those. In the absence of those, then we're going to have to focus on Social Security. We have interim targets next year, and the 2030 targets are only 70 months away. Investing in childcare and parental employment is essential and excellent for the long term. But if you're just looking at the targets, the principal lever is, at the moment, Scottish Child Payment and Social Security. But we think that you do need to look wider. Poverty is the outcome of a whole set of difficult multi-factors, and just looking at one is not going to address the problem in the longer term. So it's the easiest and most straightforward thing to do, but we do have to look at some of the other factors which make people vulnerable to poverty.
Single, can I just check then, you do or don't, it's really helpful, but you do or don't support a supplement for the Scottish Child Payment for certain targeted groups who might be more likely at risk of deep and enduring poverty? Or you do? I'm not sure what your position is.
We think it should be extended to those without recourse to public funds. The Commission, I represent an organisation, a body. We do not have a specific articulated position on variations in targeting. We're offering ideas for the Government to consider. We're fully in support of the Scottish Child Payment, but we don't want to put all our eggs in one basket. That is our concern.
That's helpful. Ruth Boyle.
Yeah, I think exactly as Stephen said, when we look at the current landscape, it's hard to imagine a better use of that money than putting it directly into parents' pockets. So we would support the increase in the level of the payment as being the starting point. Again, echo around no recourse to public funds. The Poverty Alliance is a membership organisation, and our membership would have probably vastly different views on what the priority would be if there is going to be a top-up for certain family groups. So that's something I would have to check with them. But I think something that's important in the context of this discussion is how we're putting the cost of the Scottish Child Payment into the broader socio-economic costs of poverty. So the cost of child poverty across the UK is £39 billion. IPPR Scotland have said that our health board spend £2.3 billion mitigating the impacts of poverty. So when we think about even the additional costs that you've highlighted there, Deputy Convener, I think we see that when we put those costs in the broader costs that we know our society has around poverty, they really pale in comparison. So we need to think about the return on investment from that money as well.
I was just That's helpful, Ms. Boyle. I was just checking. Their Best Start Foods is extended to those without recourse to public funds, so that maybe connects some of my earlier suggestions for targeting with Mr. Sinclair's points, but that's helpful, Mr. Evans.
We have not done the research on whether or not a different increase to the Scottish Child Payment for different groups is the most effective way to reduce poverty. It's something we'd be interested to look at and can come back to you. But I think the other part of it is to look at the depth. We started at the depth of poverty, and I think the rise of the depth of number of people in deep poverty over the last 30 years has been quite scary and chilling. The equivalent of population of Dundee is now in deep poverty. Is in deep poverty compared to what it was in 1997. So I think it is about targeting, but it's also about levels of payment as well.
Can I check, Mr. Evans, if you'd...
Can I just quickly intervene and say we're really tight for time? And if you can be as quick and concise as possible, thank you.
No matter your answer, Mr. Evans, I will not have a follow-up question after this, so the last word shall be yours. If you had a choice, Mr. Evans, and please make one on this occasion if you can, between missing that interim target of 18% by a whisker, but the actions the Scottish Government takes lifts a huge amount of people out of deep and enduring poverty, almost just to that artificial line of not being in, technically being in poverty, would you rather meet the target or move huge amounts of people away from enduring poverty?
That's quite a straightforward question for me. I'd rather lift a lot of people out of long and enduring poverty rather than meet the target. And I think when we do have a public discourse about targets and whether government are meeting or parliament are meeting or not meeting targets, our response is not just based on the what's happening with the percentages. It depends on the action. So if we see strong, good action being made to reach the targets, then we're quite willing to see that the targets are not met just by a couple of percentage points. But when we don't see the action that follows the words, that is when we start worrying about the targets being ineffective.
Very helpful. Thank you.
OK. And very lastly, Citizens Advice Scotland suggest that a greater range of evidence should be accepted as showing responsibility for a child. What are the implications of doing so? And if I could direct that to Stephen, please.
We support the Citizens Advice recommendation on that. I'm afraid I don't have anything further to add on the technicalities.
OK, and I'll just open it up to Ruth and Jack. Do you have any comments on that at all?
No.
OK. Well, that finishes our evidence session. And thank you to all of our witnesses. The committee will consider in private how it would like to take forward the evidence it has heard so far. And I will now briefly suspend the meeting for the set-up of our next agenda item. Thank you. Okay, welcome back. Our next item of business this morning is the consideration of an affirmative statutory instrument. The Carers Assistance Carer Support Payment Scotland Regulations 2024. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means that Parliament must approve them before they come into force. I welcome to the meeting Shirley-Ann Somerville, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, and I also welcome her officials from the Scottish Government, Jane Sterry, Team Leader, Carer Support Payment Policy, and Ross Grimley, Lawyer, Scottish Government. So thank you all for joining us today. And following this evidence session, the committee will be invited in the upcoming agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. So I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Convener. Carer support payment launched in November last year in Dundee City, Perth and Kinross and the Western Isles. And this is a key step in our work to transform financial support for unpaid carers in Scotland and to build a different system based on dignity, fairness and respect that recognises the value of unpaid care and provides greater stability and support for carers. Carer support payment is already delivering an improved service developed through work with carers and those that support them and extends support to many full-time students who are unable to get carers allowance. These improvements are in addition to the extra support already available to carers through our carers allowance supplement support, which is only available in Scotland. In fact, our three Scotland-only carer benefits, Carer Support Payment, Young Carers Grant and Carers Allowance Supplement, mean that in 24-25 we're investing £60 million more in carer benefits than we get from the UK Government. Carers allowance is the most complex benefit we are replacing in terms of its links with a range of other support. The pilot and our planned rollout approach have been designed to allow us to ensure robust systems are in place between Social Security Scotland and the DWP so that carers continue to get all of the support they're entitled to. In February this year, we also began the automatic transfer of carers allowance awards to carers support payment. This is taking place across Scotland with no need for carers to reapply for support and no gaps in entitlement. I'm grateful to officials from across the UK for their continued support in this work. We're now ready to expand the benefit to more carers, and the regulations you are considering today will, if approved, make carer support payment available in a further 10 local authorities this summer, starting with Angus, North and South Lanarkshire in June, and across Scotland from November 2024. The draft regulations also include special backdating rules to ensure that carers don't lose out on support where they live in areas in later phases of the rollout, and they bring forward from October to June a further extension of eligibility to carers aged 16 to 19 in full-time non-advanced education with certain exceptional circumstances. I would like to extend my thanks to the Scottish Commission on Social Security for their scrutiny of the draft amendment regulations, and I'm pleased to note that each of their recommendations have been accepted. We know communicating this rollout approach clearly will be key to its success, and we're working with the DWP to ensure both Social Security Scotland and the DWP are providing clear information to carers on the rollout approach to help ensure carers continue to access all the support they are entitled to through carer support payment and any linked benefits. And to conclude, Convener, I appreciate this opportunity to assist the committee in its consideration of the regulations, and I'm of course happy to take any questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, we'll now move on to questions. And again, our questions will be directed to you, but you are of course welcome to invite any official to respond. Should you wish to do so. So, first of all, I'm going to come in firstly and say I'm delighted to hear that the carers allowance in North and South Lanarkshire will shortly be benefiting from the Scottish Government's carer support payment, particularly that my constituency is in of East Kilbride is actually in South Lanarkshire. So, as the rollout obviously widens, my constituents will obviously warmly welcome this new support. Can you tell the committee more about work that has been going on to raise awareness of in the new pilot areas?
Thank you, Convener, and I appreciate not directly your constituency, but I was in Motherwell very recently to speak to carers there about the difference that Social Security Scotland's approach has made to them, both for them as carers and for those that they care for. And it was a fantastic opportunity for me to meet people. Yes, to hear about further improvements we still need to make, but absolutely to hear about the difference that our approach is already making to people. So I think that was a really useful event for me and my officials to take part in. With regards to the work that's going on to raise awareness, as I said in my opening remarks, this is absolutely vital so that people have an understanding of what is happening, and also again to take away any stress, particularly for those that are in the case transfer, to know that there's no obligation on them to do anything. So there's been a number of stakeholder events that have been ongoing, online roadshows for example for the rollout, and there's further roadshows planned. So far they were attended by around 270 representatives from welfare rights organisations, care support organisations, the people that the committee I think would expect us to be in contact with, and from the rollout date in June there will also be further publicity through media, social media and so on, to make sure again that we're getting that message across, both in a generic sense but also particularly to those networks that are already trusted by carers and those that they care for.
Helpful. I'm now going to invite any member who wants to come in with a question. I believe John Mason would like to come in. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. You'll not be surprised, being on the Finance Committee, I wanted to ask about the financial effects, which I was reading about in the policy note. So it says that the Scottish Fiscal Commission has decided not to produce any forecasts because there's not going to be a material impact. But is there any financial impact through this?
Well, the financial impact, in essence, will be the extended eligibility that we have. So there is a financial impact to that, and I think we discussed this in greater detail when we were taking through the original regs for the pilot area. There's also the fact that we are seeing I heard about this when I was in Motherwell, an increase in people who will come forward for benefits because that they are entitled to those, and that they're being encouraged and they feel that this is supportive. So the Scottish Fiscal Commission will present its forecasts as best they can with the information that we have, and they and we will learn as we go on about how that eligibility has made an impact, and the particular aspects around how many more people are perhaps encouraged to come forward for the entitlement that may not have done so under the previous system. That's exceptionally challenging to forecast, but I think the Fiscal Commission has to date been cognisant of that and obviously will continue to do so. So in essence, those discussions were already baked in when we took through the original pilot regulations.
So for this current year, 24-25, although you're changing some of the dates as to when things are starting, there's not really any serious impact. Can you put any figure on it? Or?
I don't have a figure to hand for that, Mr Mason. We can certainly check, but we don't expect this to be a change given the number of people that will be coming forward. This is a change in dates rather than anything else. So it's something which we've already, in essence, planned for.
OK, thank you.
OK. I believe Paul O'Kane would like to come in with a question. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. It was just to follow up on something that had been exchanged at the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee in terms of what qualifies as a temporary break in care, and they had raised the concern around those who are in a period of legal detention and whether the policy intent that would qualify as a temporary break in care would be met. Now, I understand there was exchange of letters to confirm that is still the policy intent, but I wondered if the Cabinet Secretary wanted to put anything on the record here just around that concern that was raised by the other committee.
Yes, and my thanks should go not just to this committee, to SCOS, but also to the DPLRC for their work on this. We very much appreciate the feedback on the regulations. What we have laid out in correspondence to the committee is that the carer support regulations on breaks in care have in essence been drafted to mirror the carers allowance legislation. So that obviously has been in force for some time, since the mid-1970s, I think. So there is an understanding for those that need to interpret those regulations about the language, about how this has been interpreted, and that has been the case for some time. If we were starting from absolute scratch with absolutely nothing beforehand, we may have done the drafting and the wording slightly differently, but in essence, the way that this has been drafted is something that's well recognised within the system and well understood by those who use it, both in terms of welfare rights and other people who will be supporting carers. And importantly for carers, the policy intent that it's written with is well understood by Social Security Scotland and how they will interpret that and go forward.
Okay, any further questions? Marie McNair, thank you.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. SCOS advise that a significant number of full-time student carers are expected to be eligible for carers' support payment in the final phase of the rollout. And this is obviously likely to put additional pressure on Social Security Scotland. Are you confident that training and other support and resources will be in place to assist staff to deal with the volume of these applications?
Yes, because this rollout, as I hope we've demonstrated today and in my previous attendance for the initial regulations, has been well planned. We know what our anticipated caseload will be within the agency, and therefore any changes that have to be made within resources within the agency have been planned for. One of the important aspects about how the agency is operated is the fact that there is a number of different ways flexibly that the workforce can move from one area to others. I appreciate in some areas there are specialisms and those are within those teams, but the agency is very cognisant of the need to flex depending on what's happening. This is an exceptionally busy year for the agency, in fact the busiest year that we will see coming forward, but all of that has been planned out in the workforce forecasting that we have going forward, and we don't anticipate any issues. We'll of course keep a very close eye on that. The committee will be well aware that I have kept a very close eye on the work that I have asked the agency to instigate around processing times to make sure that those came down, because they were too long when we introduced CDP and ADP. That's absolutely moving in the same direction. So I think another important aspect around this is to reassure clients that may be coming to the agency for other benefits that there will be no disbenefit to them because this has been planned very, very carefully. Cheers.
OK, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Bob Doris. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'm pleased to see this affirmative instrument here, and it seems to fall in line about government policy, but ambitious in its intent, but cautious and careful in the rollout. And I think the £60 million additional money spent on carers in Scotland gives evidence of that ambition. But you did say one thing, Cabinet Secretary, in relation to a backdating protocol that exists so that individuals wouldn't lose out. And I think you alluded to that being where an individual moves from maybe one local authority to another, one that is part of the pilot, one that isn't part or part of the rollout or otherwise. So how will that be identified by Social Security Scotland, and how will they be encouraged to make sure that they fill in the appropriate forms, I suppose, to get that backdating?
Well, it's exceptionally important that the rules around backdating are understood, and the work that has to go on in the agency to be able to ensure that if an individual is eligible for backdating, that's the responsibility of the agency to undertake that work rather than that falling onto the client. So the carers that live outside the initial pilot area who met the eligibility criteria for care support payment, but not carers' allowance, will be able to have their award backdated to the pilot launch of the benefit, where they apply within 13 weeks of the benefit being available in their areas, or they have good reason for applying later. In essence, it's the, of course, the same form, but if you're applying and there is recognition within the form that you are a student, then that's when the processes within the agency will be able to kick in about that, so that the person themselves, the client, doesn't have to do any additional work, provide any more forms for them. It's something that will be taken care of in the agency.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
OK. Does anyone have any further questions for the Cabinet Secretary? OK. If no further questions, then I'm moving on to agenda item 4. And it's a formal consideration of motion S6M13023. That the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Carers Assistance Carer Support Payment Scotland Regulations 2024 draft be approved. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and to move the motion.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. I now invite contributions from any members. No? OK. So the question is that motion S6M13023, in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville, be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, a draft report will be prepared by the clerks. Are members content to consider this draft report in private at next week's meeting? Okay, thank you, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you to your officials today as well. This concludes our public business for today, and we will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda.